why are there two genders? So let's consider our Chlamydomonas population again here. And let's go back to single-celled organisms. Let's go back to the myths of time when there were no multicellular organisms, but rather there were single-celled organisms. And we will say that sexual reproduction has gotten started as a way to avoid parasitism. Well, the problem with this type of fusion has to do with two competing sets of genes. So we know that we have nuclear genes in the nucleus. There are nuclear genes, but there are also mitochondrial genes in the mitochondria, and there are also chloroplast genes. If you're an algal cell, there are chloroplast genes. And although there's considerable mixing of the nuclear genes upon sexual reproduction in the zygote, which will provide for variability in the offspring, with respect to the mitochondrial DNA and the chloroplast DNA, there is no mixing. And there's really no advantage to the mitochondria or plastids, or the chloroplasts rather, sexual reproduction provides the organelles with no great competitive advantage. But the organelles have their own DNA, and they are seeking to outcompete other organelles because they want to be passed on to the next generation, just like nuclear genes do. And so what happens in Chlamydomonas, and we can observe this, is that there are chloroplast and mitochondrial wars. So let's look at that a second here. So when you have, let's say, a cell over here and a cell over here, and they're going to fuse by fertilization. Let's say this cell over here will just represent the plastids now, the chloroplasts or mitochondria, the organelles in other words, there, and over here we'll say there are red ones. Well, when we form offspring cells, there will be a mixture in the fusion event of organelles coming from this parent and organelles coming from this parent. And because these have an interest in competing, they go to war with each other. They go to war with each other. And they do so with DNA cutting enzymes that chop each other's DNA up. And the result can be complete destruction of the cell. And that is serving the interests of the organelles versus the nuclear genes. Well, let's not forget about the nuclear genes. And the nuclear genes here, The nuclear genes have an interest in stopping this war of the organelles because they are reaping the benefits of sex. They are recombining and producing new genetic variants. And they would like this war between the plastids to stop, between the organelles to stop. So what they do is, in Chlamydomonas, when conditions of the pond are such that fertilization will occur between 1N cells, they differentiate into plus cells and minus cells. And the plus cells essentially have more of the organelles than the minus cells do. There's relatively more of these. So the outcome becomes fixed when we produce the 2N zygote, if you will. The outcome is fixed such that the plus cell organelles will always win out over the minus cell organelles because there are more of them. So there will be uniparental inheritance of the organelles. And this is almost universally true for organisms like Chlamydomonas. So we have uniparental inheritance of the organelles, whereas the nuclear genes, let's say we have chromosomes here and we have chromosomes over here, the nuclear genes are going to be a mixture of both. So uniparental inheritance of the organelles. And then the nuclear genes arrange for this plus minus differentiation, which brokers this outcome, if you will. They do that by putting on the cell surface certain molecules. Well, I won't put them here. They'll put certain molecules on the surface. Let's say a minus cell has certain molecules on its surface, and plus cells have certain molecules on its surface that allow only plus minus fusion. So minus cells can fuse with plus cells. And that is what will give rise to the next generation. Minus cells can't recognize minus cells, and plus cells can't recognize plus cells. So we always have plus minus fusions. And in organisms, multicellular organisms, we will see, have taken this to an extreme. And that is the following. In the production of sperm, what we have is basically an extreme case of minus cells. The sperm can virtually contribute no organelles to the zygote. We have uniparental inheritance of organelles because they are inherited through the egg. So in a way, the eggs are, we can think of as plus cells, and we can think of the sperm as minus cells, taken to an extreme case where they've shed virtually all of their cytoplasm and are only a nuclear gene delivery vehicle to the egg. So in multicellular organisms, they've taken this to an extreme. And in a way, we can reverse that and say that, in fact, the selection pressures to evolve multicellularity have to do with the adoption of extreme minus routes of differentiation versus plus differentiation of haploid cells. Because although eggs you would recognize as a cell perfectly capable of living on its own, if it were a single-celled organism, say, like Chlamydomonas, a sperm simply cannot. It does not have the material that would allow it to exist as a free-living cell. And therefore, when you go down this route, you need multicellularity. You need multicellular life in order to support the development and the support of these extreme minus cells, the sperm. So in a way, multicellularity probably evolved as a way to support increasingly enfeebled minus gametes, or we would now refer to them as male gametes. So this is why we, number one, we think sex evolved, and number two, why there are two genders. There's a plus gender and a minus gender. There's a male and a female in sexually reproducing organisms. And in something simple like Chlamydomonas, it's simply a plus and a minus situation. But in organisms like ourselves, it's male and female. Males being the minus, females being the plus. So that is an answer to two big evolutionary questions that have to do with sexual reproduction. And given all that now, let's get to the mechanisms and chromosome behavior that occur during the processes of meiosis. So now we'll tackle meiosis. The word comes from the Greek, meiosis, which means to diminish or reduce. So it is in meiosis that we will take a 2N genome and reduce it to 1N haploid set of the genome in the gametes. So before we enter into that, there's something I want you to keep in mind, and that is that just like mitosis, we have replicated homologous chromosomes. But the chromosomes are going to be behaving differently in meiosis than in mitosis. First of all, there are going to be two cell divisions with no DNA replication in between those cell divisions. That's very un-mitosis-like, but characterizes meiosis. And the second thing is that the replicated homologous chromosomes, one homologous chromosome that was inherited paternally and one replicated chromosome that was inherited maternally, pair or synapse during the first prophase of meiosis. They actually synapse prior to prophase of the first meiotic division. And so they pair up like this. And now we're going to do our finger trick again. Remember we did this for mitosis? Let's do it once again. Let's remind ourselves of mitosis. Here is our chromosomes, homologous chromosomes for a homologous chromosome pair. In mitosis, Replication occurs during the S phase, and in mitosis, they line up on the metaphase plate, and anaphase, they segregate to daughter cells. There's a daughter cell on top and a daughter cell on the bottom. Now let's do the same thing for meiosis. Homologous chromosomes replicate during the S phase of prior to meiosis, to the first meiotic division, but instead of being independent of one another, they synapse, they pair with each other. And they line up on the metaphase plate of meiosis one as so, replicated, and the chromatids in anaphase of meiosis one do not separate from each other, but rather the replicated homologous chromosomes separate from each other and the two daughter cells. And then no DNA replication occurs in those daughter cells, no S phase, in other words. They immediately proceed to a mitotic-like division in which each cell is divided in two, and there's an anaphase which is very mitotic-like, in that the chromatids now separate from each other and go to daughter cells. So in two successive cell divisions, we end up with four meiotic products, each of which inherit a single chromosome from a chromosome set. And we're going to see how that works right now. The homologous chromosomes, as we've said, are replicated and they synapse with each other, but the chromatids will not separate in the first meiotic division. And there are points at which they cross over that we call synaptonemal complexes. And those are involved in holding the chromosomes together, but are also the sites of crossing over, chromosomal crossing over. In this process, a chromatid of one homologous chromosome and a chromatid of another homologous chromosome, an actual physical exchange of the genetic material occurs between these. We call those the crossover sites. The synaptonemal complexes are involved in that crossing over process. And we end up with what we would say is kind of a mosaic, a mixture of genetic material that occurs as these exchange DNA molecules. Now we're going to spend a lot of time talking about crossing over and recombination, but we're going to put that off for the time being until we get to genetics, till we get to transmission genetics. So let's leave that aside right now. So here we have prophase of meiosis one, paired replicated homologous chromosomes. In metaphase of meiosis one, there are these paired homologous chromosomes that are replicated line up, and they are pulled in anaphase of meiosis one to opposite poles. The entire replicated chromosomes are. There's no division of the chromatids. That's unlike mitosis, where the chromatids are separated at anaphase one. Now, in metaphase one, we would have something that looks like this. And then anaphase one, we see that the replicated chromosomes are being pulled apart. And then we have produced two daughter cells, each of which contain replicated homologous chromosomes. And then they proceed into metaphase two, that is meiosis two, which has a metaphase stage. And at this point, they line up in the middle of the cell at a metaphase plate. And during anaphase of meiosis two, the sister chromatids will now be pulled apart to opposite poles. So that we will end up with, since each cell is doing this in meiosis two, and each cell is a product of meiosis one, we will end up with four gametic products. So we can go through this process, and you can pause at will and examine this process. And we end up with four gametic products then. In mitosis, we end up with two daughter cells that are each 2N, or each diploid. But in meiosis, we end up with four daughter cells, each of which has a haploid complement of genetic material. So you need to practice this and understand the behavior of chromosomes during meiosis. This will be very important as we tackle transmission genetics. Now in the next segment of this lecture, before we get into transmission genetics, we'll look at some of the consequences of the meiotic process going awry.